Welcome back. I hope you had a nice, what I guess turned out to be about a half an hour ago or so, but that's fine. Discussion and a break there from what was a very, very stimulating panel. Now, I said at the beginning of this Trade and Development Symposium 2015 that I was very excited about this next subject matter, because one thing you might not know is that I've been working closely with Her Excellency the Commissioner from the African Union Commission, my company, and we've already done quite a bit on African integration. We're real believers, and I think that that's what ties everybody together. This panel is the best panel probably that you could put together on this subject. Her Excellency Fatima Haram Asil, Commissioner for Trade and Industry for the African Union Commission, is to my left there. Give her a round of applause, please. Mr. Jean-Louis Bilon is the Minister of Commerce for Côte d'Ivoire, and we're very glad to have you here, sir. That is a powerhouse company, a country in West Africa that is doing a lot and is really committed to African integration. Now, I have this back to front on my, so I have to be slow here. Yes, Mr. Gabriel Negatu is the Regional Director for a very important organization. He's the Eastern African Regional Center for the African Development Bank Group. You're very welcome, sir. We've heard talk about the next gentleman's organization. He's the Chief Executive Officer of a very, I wanted to say peculiar, but I say that in a positive way, because I don't think it's quite unique, I think is the word I'm looking for. A unique organization that is supercharging trade in East Africa, with the implementation, their center to what is happening and what is transforming this continent. That's Trademark East Africa's Chief Executive Officer, Mr. Frank Matsart. I said I had a good crowd for you. I've got, finally, last but not least, I do apologize for putting you right at the end there, but I know you can hold your own. That's Ms. Annabel Gonzalez, who's the Senior Director, Global Practice on Trade and Competitiveness, am I getting that right, for the World Bank Group, Okay, now, so good afternoon anyway, and a warm welcome to this, the second plenary of the Trade and Development Symposium, the first one in Africa. This one called Africa Integrates. And next door, the KICC, maybe 5,000 to 6,000 to 7,000 trade delegates from the four corners of the earth will meet to discuss the future of the global trading system for the first time on African soil. And so this provides a unique opportunity to put Africa and its place in the global trading arena at the center of the discussions. After all, with 43 out of the 162 members of the World Trade Organization, African countries represent over a quarter of the WTO's stakeholders. Simple question then. How can what is decided over there at the KICC help Africa trade with Africa and with the wider world? Now here's a sobering statistic, and if my my clicker is working, is it? What am I pointing at? Is it working? Great. Great. This is going to be a good one. Okay. Take a look at that, some sobering statistics. Intra-African trade, that's the percentage of trade that African countries do with each other, is a mere 12 or 13%. Now, that you compare that to Asia, where it's 30%, or North America, where it's 40%, or Europe, where it's 60%. These are World Bank figures, by the way, Annabel. Yes? Obviously, something has to change, but I believe that the things that disconnect us are not just greed. They're not really geographic. That's not the issue. They're not geographic. Yes, they are, but that's not wholly what divides us. It's the different rules, the regulations, and the practices of our disparate markets and Africa's place in the global market that should be challenged. We need definitely to begin with a common way of doing things. That's the first thing. Integration is not just about the exchange of goods and services either. It's also about the exchange of ideas, African ideas in particular. Opening borders to each other will open ourselves to ourselves so that we can share ideas, share technologies. Frank, I'm coming to you on that one. Share technologies and best practices. We'll be able to better tackle the common challenges together. And let me tell you, the world is not waiting for Africa. Over the next 4 days at the Trade and Development Symposium, you'll hear a lot about mega regionals. Agreements that are emerging, that are actually changing the very, very makeup and fabric and playground of trade. Africa needs to respond to the changing face of trade. Now, as Her Excellency the AUC Trade Commissioner said once in the Financial Times newspaper, our real strength lies in our unity. See, I do listen. Put simply, Africa must trade with Africa. And that's what we're going to be talking about. Without much ado, I'd like to invite to the stage, just to open this session, Her Excellency Fatima Haram Asil, Commissioner for Trade and Industry, the African Union Commission. Give her a round of applause, please.
Well, thank you very much, and good afternoon to all of you. Thank you, Mark, our moderator here. I think every single time that he come and moderate a session, now you wonder if really what you have prepared is the right thing to say. So I'm going to actually take my talking point a little bit upside down and kind of talk about African integration and why it is important, African integration, and why we in Africa have no choice but to integrate. So I'm going to start that way, and then I can come to a conclusion. One is, as you're all aware, Africa is composed of 54 countries, but most of them are small, with population fewer of 20 million and economies less than 10 billion. 12 of them had a population of less than 2 million and 19 a GDP of less than 5 million in 2008. Again, this is a statistic from the World Bank in 2008. National market, therefore, are too small to justify huge amount of investment. We all talk about infrastructure challenges in Africa. We need infrastructure. No country in the world developed, industrialized, have their infrastructure because other came to pay for them. So it's very important that we have enough market, we have integration to justify, to attract investment so that we can actually have our infrastructure developed. We also know that both adequate supply of input and sufficient client base is too expensive, to reach. So continental free trade area is a way of addressing challenges of scale that face the African producers. We know that Africa, we can be competitive in agriculture. Today, we're talking about food security. How do we feed ourselves? And we have the potential of feeding ourselves. Food security actually is important, it's a dignity problem. And therefore, with the continental free trade area, we can ensure food security by reduction of rate of production of trade in agricultural products among African countries. We also know that we have issues of competitiveness for Africa's industrial product through harnessing the economies of scales of a large continental market. If we have a large continental market, we can talk about economy of scale. Diversification, we all say we African countries are producing the same goods, and we're not diversified enough so that we can boost our intra-African trade, which currently stayed at 12%, compared to the world. When you look at North America, when you look at Europe, we're talking about 60%, 40%, the Asia 30%. How do we do to boost our intra-African trade? How do we diversify our economy? And that's why CFTA, again, Continental Free Trade Area, is very important to help us diversify, transform our economy, and also the ability to supply its import needs from our own resources. Better allocation of resources, improve competition, as I said, and reduce price differential among African countries. The growth of intra-industry trade and the development of geographically based specification in Africa. We also seen that our youth are dying on the seas. When you talk about the Mediterranean, they're most of them going to Europe for employment. What do we do to create the employment here in Africa? So it's very important that we talk about the value chain, the regional value chain, the specialization, the movement of people. Movement of people is very critical Because if we can move among ourselves, it's going to be also reducing that risk of going outside, our youth dying. And that's why in the upcoming January 2016 summit, we from the African Union Commission are going to give an African Union passport to all our head of state and government. The purpose of this is to ensure that this African passport, first of all, is accepted by all the African countries, because we have few that even though we have a passport, EU passport, they're still asking us for visa. So that's important. The second thing that is also important is we're going to take top business people such as Dangote and other, give them that African passport so they will not find visas to go in the same countries, and later on develop criteria for business people, how are they going to get this African passport, so we can talk about practical way of movement of people. Because when we talk about continental free trade area, we're talking about movement of goods, services, and people. Basically, goods cannot move by themselves, so it's very, very important that we talk also about the movement of people. By also integrating ourselves, we reduce the vulnerability of Africa to external trade shock. It's also important that today, as an African Union, we're not member of the WTO. We don't even have an observer status. Yet, 40 out of 160 members of the WTO are African. Today, if we're united, if we speak with one voice, if we integrate as a continent, no organization will succeed until Africa gets what Africa wants. So it's very important that we integrate, we speak with one voice, and move forward. The participation of Africa in the global trade, and also, is very important. So, again, the CFTA is not only, it has so many benefits, but it's also to mitigate the costs associated with inaction. Today, as you're aware, Mark just said, the world is not waiting on Africa. Negotiations are going on. We know the TTIPs are going on. Other, mega trends are going on. Where is leaving the place in Africa? Nobody is thinking. The US is negotiating with the EU. Where is Africa? We have the economic partnership with the EU. We have AGOA with the US, but yet they're negotiating, and we're not party to the negotiation. So we also believe in Africa that the multilateralism is very good. It's a very good platform. We want to save it. We want also this WTO to succeed. We want the Doha round to succeed. However, this is a Doha round. We need also to get development outcome. If we don't get development outcome in this round, we will never get it again. So that's also very important. But based on all of this and more, I know that I only have 5 minutes, and I don't know if I exceeded my 5 minutes. Based on all of this, that's why our head of state and government in 2012 came with that bold decision to say we must establish a continental free trade area by 2017. We must boost our intra-African trade for that current 12%. And of course, to boost intra-African trade, we have to look at the productive capacity, we have to look at the trade facilitation, we have to look at trade-related infrastructure, a market factor, and so forth. The infrastructure is very important, the trade finance is important. And actually, the head of state and government, this June 2015, at their summit in Johannesburg, they launched the negotiation. We're going to proceed with the negotiation, and it's also the continental free trade area was also placed as being one of the flagship project of the African Union of the Agenda 2063. On this Agenda 2063 of the African Union, that vision, we developed a 10-year plan. The continental free trade area is part of that 10-year plan. 2017 is the target. We must work on that target to achieve our head of state and government. Every 6 months, they meet to review progress, address challenges, so we can move ahead. Of course, there are so many other areas, such as infrastructure. We're talking about how to connect Africa via high-speed train. We're talking about electricity. We're talking about silencing the gun. But all these things are holistic, and development are essential for the African continent. It's essential. Integration is essential for also our peace and security. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Am I on? No, maybe here. Okay. Wake him up. Okay. Thank you very much, Honourable Commissioner, for that. You summed it up quite well. Now, if you could indulge me, my esteemed panel, I want to go this way down and just, in a nutshell, 2 or 3 minutes, from your own unique perspectives, and they are unique, just give me your own thoughts on regional integration, on African integration. Now, I'm going to start with Mr. Jean-Louis Billon, who is the Minister of Commerce in Côte d'Ivoire. Ivory Coast has done so much. I mean, you really are moving fast over there. I don't know if a lot of people actually know what is happening in Côte d'Ivoire when it comes to both trade development and regional integration. But you could tell us, just tell us some of the things you're doing and your approach in Côte d'Ivoire. We're having some mic problems over here.
Thank you, Mark. Well, Ivory Coast has African integration within its constitution. So when you start to read the constitution of the country, it says that Ivory Coast will help to promote African integration because we want, by true African integration, promote also African unity. So it's written in the constitution. So very early, the late president, Félix Houphouët-Boigny, decided to make the country the roundabout for trade in West Africa. And we had peace for more than 40 years before we started the crisis. But that stability gave a strategic position for the country. And the port of Abidjan and San Pedro were not designed only for the country, but to serve also countries of the interland like Burkina Faso, Mali, and Niger. So the private sector is also working not only for Ivory Coast, but we consider the entire West Africa region. I can give you my own example. Before entering the government, I was running my family company, and half of the sales were done between Senegal, Burkina, Mali, and the other half in the Ivory Coast. So without the West African Economic Union and the ECOWAS, we couldn't make it. Okay. So it's very important to know. It's not easy because we still have too many hurdles. Infrastructure, I think Fatima pointed out, it's difficult today to, like you can do in Europe or to some extent in Asia, to go back and forth during the same day from one African capital to the other.
Yes, no, I think you mentioned Andy Kodambo just a few weeks ago. He was telling me that he needs 34 passports to go across Africa. That's the richest island in Africa.
Yeah.
34 passports.
Because when you're traveling all the year, you finish a passport every 3 months. So,
so you need the jumbo passports.
Yeah, counting the visas. So that's going to be the biggest challenge with the African Union free trade zone already. Within the ECOWAS country, it's okay. It's probably the most accomplished. In on the African continent.
ECOWAS is further ahead than other regions.
Yeah, and within ECOWAS you have the WEMU, the West Africa Economic Zone, which is the franc zone with the same banking system. And we had a single currency long before the euro. Okay, but it's still not perfect. We're moving fast, but we need more infrastructures and probably more companies and the services that goes with the infrastructure, shipping lines, seas, airlines, railroads, highways. In the past, with the camel caravans, Africa was already integrated before the frontiers. And now we are working on it on the modern way through trade, but we need to adapt to those modern way of doing trade with roads, airlines, and everything.
And one of the things that definitely needs to adapt and evolve very quickly is the financial structure. How are we going to pay for all this? How is money going to flow? What are the, how are we going to evolve a robust financial structure that would encourage inter-regional trade? Now, that's why I'm so glad to have Mr. Gabriel Negantu, who is the Eastern African Regional Director for the African Development Bank Group. Now, you now have a new president. He happens to be one of my countrymen, and he was the former Akinwumi Adeshina, the former agricultural minister. And he's so passionate about agriculture. So I don't know what you're going to say, but maybe you could squeeze agriculture in there as well.
Okay. Let me just use the
yes, I think you're mic on the lapel.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Suppose everything I say will have some bearing on agriculture, but what I want to flag is perhaps two or three points vis-a-vis where are we going with this integration in inter-African trade. One is the most common discussion, and the Commissioner also highlighted, is the issue of infrastructure. Yes, infrastructure. We know that it's happening, whether it's power, roads, ICT, infrastructure really will happen better. This infrastructure will only be effective. It will be effective if it's complemented by trade facilitation measures.
While we all dwell on infrastructure, which absolutely is the bedrock of the physical integration, the effort to build Africa's infrastructure must, out of necessity, be complemented by trade facilitation measures that are designed to simplify and facilitate the inter-regional trade and reduce the kind of bureaucracy that today defines the space. I can tell you there's nothing worse than having spent a couple hundred million dollars to build a road and to finally complete it and to have trucks zooming down that highway only to come to the border and then be delayed by 3 days, 8 days, 3 hours, whatever the case may be. And Frank will come, but it is the reality. So infrastructure, yes, but plus. So we need to keep that in mind. The second issue that we see from where I sit in the East Africa region is the need to revisit these rules of origin types of barriers. Really, I mean, there are no types barriers, but we tend to create these artificial barriers, and if a country wants to exclude trade with another country, there's always something you can pick on. So this red tape and generally the rules of origin is hampering intra-African trade, particularly in the agriculture sector. If you want to buy a truckload of wheat from Tanzania to Kenya, you would probably go, well, I was going to say you'll lose your hair, but you've already lost your hair, so let me just say you'll probably get old waiting for that truck to come through because of all kind of mentality barriers. So I think infrastructure, yes, but again, these mentality barriers, especially rules of origin. And then thirdly is, within infrastructure, there needs to be some prioritization. Some infrastructure is more integrating than others. Like ICT, great enabler, roads, power, and so on. So as we look to infrastructure, let's look for those infrastructure that facilitate and connect trade. And then there are others that are more political. So this would be my three messages.
Thank you very much, Ms. Gabriel Negantu. Frankie, singing your tune, infrastructure. Just the sort of a 1 minute short version of what TMEA is, because he was singing to your heart there, no doubt.
Well, first of all, it's great to be here today, and thanks a lot for those kind words. I guess at Trademark East Africa, we're set up as a special purpose vehicle, really, to try to support trade development. And as Gabriel said, we do a lot of work in partnership with the African Bank, the World Bank. I feel like I'm in the middle of my two partners here. But essentially, you know, what we aim to do is try to be your flexible friend in between to help things happen quickly. But also, as Gabriel said, you know, to do the soft side. You can build a border post, but what good is a border post? It's a building, it may be an improved road, but unless that border post is operated efficiently, it doesn't have any payoff. So I think mixing the soft side with the hard side is really important. So without getting border authorities to really do their thing properly and automate that process, you know, that border investment doesn't mean anything. And it's similarly the same for ports. You can spend a huge amount of money, and we work a lot on ports, upgrading port infrastructure, but unless you can basically get a box off a ship and onto a truck quickly, it's not going to pay back for you. So I think, you know, that's what we try to do at Trademark, but we do a fair bit also with the private sector, because all of this has got a benefit.
You're based here, your headquarters is here in Nairobi.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, no, we're based here, and our program now is about 6 years old, and, you know, we built the portfolio up to be about a $600 million program. So we do a lot of work on ports, on borders, on the soft side, standards, as well as NTBs, and I think those are important issues as well. So
you're at the center of getting your boots dirty, rolling up your sleeves when it comes to integration. You're doing the nitty-gritty, the nuts and bolts. From your own perspective, from your bird's-eye perspective, do you see what's our chances of success, perhaps I should ask you?
Well, I think really good. I mean, you know, first of all, it's a really important agenda for Africa. As you said, Commissioner, you know, Africa needs to trade more with itself. So it's a market on our doorstep. I think only 12% of trade broadly in the East African community is intra-regional trade. Might be as high as 16% by some measures.
We're broken it down here, Frank. You got it there. To the different regions right now. In Kumasi, 6%. EAC is doing best, I think, at 12%. Then you have the ECCAS, 2%. ECOWAS, my region, 9%. And SADC, 13%.
So, I mean, that's a huge challenge. You know, if you compare it to Europe, where we're talking around over 60%, the potential for intra-Africa trade is huge. And that's huge, basically, for trading across borders and getting goods across into markets. And I think the locational advantage for a lot of African firms is there. There's a doorstep, there's a market on your doorstep. And we're certainly seeing firms taking advantage of that in East Africa once these trade barriers come down. So I think the potential is huge. And Africa is integrating already. Look at the East African community, the gains that have been made. Now with the tripartite free trade area, the continental free trade area, this is a process that's moving forward. And I think, personally, I'm very optimistic about the future. And if you take East Africa as anything to go by, the amount of gains have been huge. One measure that we measure our own success on is how long it takes to get a container from a port of entry, so Mombasa and Dar es Salaam in East Africa's case, to a destination. For example, Kampala, Kigali, Juba, over to Bujumbura. And, you know, those times have fallen massively. Back in 2010, it used to take 18, 20 days to get a container to Kampala. You can now do that in around 6 to 8 days. That's a huge change. And it goes to show the sort of changes that, you know, if you really get serious about dealing with infrastructure and policies and integrating your trade regimes, a lot can happen.
We have one more slide. These slides are put together by the SANA Institute, one of their key partners at the Trade and Development Symposium. And this shows that the evidence suggests that the WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement should be an integral part of the African integration agenda. And if you look at it, it says that establishing the continental free trade areas at 52% increase in intra-African trade, and then doing it together with the trade facilitation measures effectively, that jumps to 128%. Now, I always enjoy reading what you write, Anna. In fact, you wrote a very nice piece on the World Bank website, which I recommend. It's kind of a what to expect from the WTO. So if you haven't seen it, just go to the World Bank website. Yeah. It sums it up beautifully in 3 or 4 pages. So I just want to get your mention there is the Trade Facilitation Agreement. So I guess if you can answer, what are the synergies that can be reaped from the Trade Facilitation Agreement and regional integration? Perhaps you want to speak on that. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Mark. And I definitely want to say a word to that. But before going there, let me give you another example of the challenge that has been well identified here. which is the fragmentation of the African market. And if the residents of San Francisco, California, face the same charges in crossing the Bay Bridge to Oakland, where a number of them go to work, as do residents crossing the Congo River between Kinshasa and Brazzaville, a similar distance, they would pay more than $1,200 for a round trip. As a result, passenger traffic at this obvious focal point for cross-border exchanges between the two Congos is around five times smaller than between East and West Berlin in 1988, which, mind you, was well before the fall of the Berlin Wall. So this shows the impact in practice that these numbers, you know, that these barriers have in Africa. Actually, the cost of trade, intra-African trade, are 50% higher than in East Asia, and are the highest in all of the developing world. So there is a very important issue here to be addressed if we want to move towards greater regional integration in Africa. And you made a very good point that trade facilitation is key to all of this. And let me say that we at the World Bank Group, along with our partners, including Trade East Africa, Trademark East Africa, and others, are working very much on this in trying to promote implementation of the Trade Facilitation Agreement in Africa. Actually, half of the support that we provide, trade-related assistance, is for implementation of the Trade Facilitation Agreement, simplifying customs procedures, making them more expedient, bringing in more transparency, promoting better coordination in border management. All of these are very important issues. We now have an additional instrument, which is the Trade Facilitation Support Facility, that aims at providing support. So we're working, for instance, with Mali, Botswana, and Zambia for the development of trade information portals. We're working with Rwanda on improving coordination at border management, with Ethiopia on the establishment of a national single window. And all of this, again, because of the positive impact that implementation of the Trade Facilitation Agreement can have in improving the transparency of the custom, of the rules of procedures, in terms of the timeliness and predictability of crossing borders, in terms of improving coordination among government agencies, and reducing corruption, which is also a major impediment to trade.
That is the point. I want to move on from what you said. We're here in the shadow. We literally are in the shadow of the WTO. I think it's 8,500 meters down the road. That's why the most of us are here. This parallel event is drawn in the conversation. But since I have you in my grasp at the moment, Fatima, I just want you to respond. The WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement, what are the synergies that can be reaped from your grand plan for the continental free trade area, and for greater synergies between the African nations? How does it play?
I think we have to note that trade facilitation for Africa is not about just WTO. As I said, when the head of state and government agreed about boosting, you know, like the continental free trade area, establishment of the continental free trade area in 2012, and also the boosting intra-African trade, they came up with seven clusters. And out of these seven clusters, trade facilitation is one of them. So it was recognized by head of state and government that we really must work on trade facilitation along with the trade-related infrastructure, along with the productive capacity, the market factor, and so forth. So for us in Africa, implementing the trade facilitation is really helping our boosting intra-African trade to increase from that low 12% to 22%, you know, in the near future. We're talking about the decades. You know, if we have, you know, measure of trade facilitation and so forth, it will increase. And actually, you have the statistic in front of you. You know, with trade facilitation in continental free trade area, 128%. I think this is a significant number. We have been, as an African Union Commission, working with the SANA Institute, working with the WTO, and all the other partners to see how we can help our member state to actually implement that trade facilitation, whether being in the categories, ABCs, whether what is the needs, and of course, in order for the countries to get the assistance, they need to declare what can they do, what they need help to do, and what are the C's that, you know, they must have that part to do. And actually, Annabel talked about, you know, the trade facilitation facility, which actually, as an African Union Commission, we're very happy to have it, you know, when it was announced by WTO. Also, with all our partners, whether being the European Union, whether being, you know, US and all other, we're always, you know, working on them to see how they can help our countries to, you know, make sure that, you know, we comply, we implement that trade facilitation. And I think that we always encourage our member countries to do so. And here also, another occasion, when we talk about WTO, you know, ministerial conference, that's another occasion for our member states to step forward and come and really implement that trade facilitation. We agree to it. It's a binding commitment, and I think it's important that we implement it, not just because it's a binding commitment, but it's also because this is how we're going to help our intra-African trade, and as I said, it's a cluster. One of the clusters of the boosting intra-African trade. So if you are serious about implementing boosting intra-African trade, we have to be serious about trade facilitation. Thank you.
Angela from Manila wants to know this. What is the point of the WTO in a world that is joining into mega regional trade agreements like the Trans-Pacific Partnership? What on earth is the point of the WTO? Frank, maybe. What do you think? Do you want to take that one?
You want me to?
Anybody. From your own unique perspective. Sorry, Frank.
Gosh, that was a bit of a surprise. Well, you know, I think the... I think the World Trade Organization plays a very important role. It obviously is a huge powerhouse of knowledge, number one. And secondly, it really gives, in my view, LDCs a really coordinated voice to get their agenda onto the agenda. And I think without the WTO, if it fragmented into mega regionals or a whole lot of other agreements, that would be really a big loss. And certainly, you know, it's beholden on the world to try to really come to some form of general agreements in terms of helping trade happen. For Africa, I think the movement forward of the whole WTO negotiations is incredibly important.
I think that it's very important to bear in mind that the World Trade Organization is, I would argue, the most important pillar in global governance of international trade. It basically establishes the rules and disciplines that govern trade in a number of areas. But it also serves important functions in terms of providing transparency in terms of the trade regimes of each of the members of the WTO. And it also has a very important function in terms of solving disputes on international trade issues. So it's, as I was saying, a very significant pillar of global governance that is being complemented, or has been complemented, by regional agreements and mega-regional agreements. And it is important to find a way to connect the regional agreements and the mega-regional agreements with the WTO so as to make sure that both of them continue to deliver on this function of promoting the global governance. And one way of doing it is through the negotiation of plurilateral agreements, which are actually taking place in the organization at this moment. So a very important organization, very important for African countries and for all countries to provide stability, predictability in terms of trade.
This is the first WTO on African soil. That's why you're here. The newspapers will shout it from the rooftops for the next 4 days, so I have to address the elephant in the room. What are your expectations from your own unique perspectives, from an Africa perspective, what Africa will get out of this WTO? I know that's a very simple question, but you'll all have slightly varying answers. Perhaps I should start with Gabriel Negatu. I'm sure you're going to have a lot of meetings over the course of the next few days. I just want to see, from your perspective, what you'll be pushing for.
Let me just touch on the previous caller's message about the WTO. I agree with everything that's been said. Learned people who know what they're talking about. But from where I sit, sometimes when you sit on the ground, you can't help but wonder whether WTO has really detracted us from a more sort of inward-looking, robust conversation about inter-African.
It's interesting.
At the end of the day, I mean, if I want to trade with my brother in Cote d'Ivoire, I don't need to go through Geneva and this and that to do that. And yet we are not doing that.
and we're all caught up on this WTO agreement, which the process, an important one, all the same, but I at this time help to wonder if it's become a detraction from the more nuanced intra-Africa trade. Having said that, I think my expectation, modest as it is that some of the issues around the development, around the Doha round, find their way into the Nairobi round in the conversation here, because it's been said that the Doha round is now dead, and I think most developing countries saw a lot of opportunities there, but on things like agriculture, access to pharmaceutical products, and so on, things that matter to financials on the ground. I hope they find a way to get voice in that process. Other than that, I'm sort of modest or limited expectation.
Jean, I'd like you here, because you're here having a series of meetings involved as one of the WTO members. I think someone mentioned, I think it was Fatima mentioned, that 25% of the members of the WTO are African nations like yours, right? I just want you to put us and give us a fly on the wall kind of perspective of what you'll be taking, the thoughts you'll be taking into over the next few days from an Africa perspective.
I think Gabriel said it, we shouldn't forget the development program for global. If we come here in Nairobi and we lose this fact, then we lost our negotiation. The challenge for Africa, most African countries today, is the development of their country, the development of their economy. And we can do it through trade, but we won't do it if we don't have competitive economies, and get competitive economies, we need to develop our country. So that's the point. I think with the WTO, we've come a long way since the General Trade Agreement, moving to WTO, and the Cancun meeting, that was a failed meeting. And then we moved to Hong Kong, and finally we had an agreement in Bali. When we failed in Cancun, we were left with nothing at all. And negotiating with the European Union for the EPA and with the US, with Angola.
Thank you. Well, I think that EPAs in general provide a strengthened sort of blueprint for the relations between the European Union and Africa and the different regions and countries in Africa. It also provides certainty of access for African products into the European market. It also provides access to European products to the African market, and then enhances the opportunities of consumers in Africa, but also of firms in Africa, because I think that the disciplines that are included in these agreements can facilitate the participation of African countries in regional and global value chains. And by having access to inputs of high quality that are then part of the international production networks, this is something that opens new opportunity for African countries. Now, free trade agreements or economic partnership agreements are not in opposition to the WTO. The WTO allows the formation of regional trade agreements, of bilateral trade agreements, or maybe regional trade agreements, and the EPAs are covered under this provision of the WTO.
Do you want to chime in, Honourable Commissioner?
Yes, thank you very much. I would say also one thing about Nairobi. I think it's very important to understand that for us, at least at the African Union Commission, hosting this ministerial in Kenya is actually not just a proud of Kenya, to Kenya, but also to our African countries. So we want actually the ministerial to succeed. But we also want to make sure that we get development outcomes. As the minister said, this is a development round. If we don't get anything now, when are we going to get an outcome? So I think that we come with this mentality, we're ready to negotiate, we're ready to, as the Director General say, understand the global, what we can give, what we can take, but we definitely want, you know, this minister to succeed. Now, as far as the EPA, our member state went ahead and signed the EPA. Some of them are countries, some of them are regions. Our take from the African Union Commission is to make sure that this economic partnership agreement does not jeopardize our continental and integration regional effort, because it's going to be difficult to have different custom union, you know, from different regions and to come and integrate. So we want to make sure, and actually we managed at the EU-Africa summit to put a language to say that we have the right to come at any time and review the EPAs if they're threatening our regional integration effort. And I think that that's accepted by the economic, you know, by the EU. The second thing, when you look at Africa, most of us are least developed countries, 34 of us. Mm-hmm. And actually the 34th has access to the European market, everything but arm. But because of our regional integration, we went ahead and most of us signed as a bloc. And I think that this is important, but it's the most important thing is to ensure that nothing that we sign jeopardize our regional integration, our unity, our regional integration. This is our strength, and it's very important that we preserve it. Thank you.
Now, the regional integration theme, this panel of superheroes was put together actually thanks to the Sana Institute, who are running this this section together with the TMEA. So I just want to go over here, and I spy in the audience Tom Pengelly, the MD of Sana. Stand up, sir. Job well done.
My question was, it's great seeing East Africa and West Africa represented, with African Bank mediating between the two of them, and World Bank next door, and the AU keeping a close eye as well. So I just had a question to Minister Billon and Frank Matsoff from Trademark East Africa. Do you think there's scope for more kind of learning from each other in West and East Africa? Is there more cooperation that these two regions that are going very fast in their own sub-regions, could they join forces and help drive the integration on the continent, working together as sort of twin engines, driving that faster? And perhaps there's things that Minister Bouillon said that are happening fast in West Africa that...
And maybe could we see a Trademark West Africa in the near future? Is that something that could fly? Thank you.
Okay. Well, I'm saying yes, of course, but not only between the region, but also between the countries. Today, when we receive an investor,
a foreign direct investor, coming from the US or from Japan or from Europe, what he tells me is that Kenya is doing well, and we should look at Kenya in the doing business process and look at it as an example and see what we can improve in the Ivory Coast to match Kenya attractiveness. Okay, so we are competing to attract investors, but also we are competing in improving our countries. The bad thing is we are far away from each other. We have a 3 hours difference, and we need more than six hours to get from Abidjan to here. So that tells you how Africa is big. But between Ivory Coast and Ghana, we are also competing. We're looking at each other and see how we can...
You're building a road, are you not?
Yeah. But at the same time, we supply energy to Ghana and Mali and Burkina. So we're working together in improving the development because... and this is not only true for Africa, it's true for the entire world. We are better off with neighbors who are doing well than with neighbors who are in crisis or in deep poverty. And I think the world will be better off if Africa is developed tomorrow with rich consumers than what we have today. When you see the crisis in Europe, the slowing growth in China, which drives the world economy slower, if you have a dynamic African continent, then the world will be much better off. So.
I think it's amazing when you look at the political will of our leaders in East Africa and just how much they've been doing. It's really amazing, and I think that that's setting aside national interests to really think about a wider framework of cooperation is a really important thing, and particularly trying to reduce... Is it me in this microphone? It's really about, you know, trying to think of the collective good rather than the individual interests, and I think that's really rather important. But certainly, you know, there's a lot of opportunity, in my view, on lots of border posts development. I think we've learned quite a lot. Perhaps, as Annabelle said, you know, some things that we should have done, but some things that have worked really well. I think there's also a lot of great progress made on customs here. And actually, port development is a bit of an area where East Africa is beginning to really pull up its socks. And I think, personally, there'll be a lot of experience there. We certainly be interested to get behind some of that cross-learning. And I think we're having a breakfast later on this week of West African trade ministers to discuss some of these very things with the Dutch minister. So I look forward to seeing you there with some luck.
Can we move on to another question over here? Or, Annabelle, it looks like you're itching to get in there.
No, I think that we've been talking here about the importance of reducing barriers to intra-African trade. Now, I would like to offer a few suggestions of how can this be done based on some work that that we have been doing at the World Bank Group. Our experience basically suggests that effective integration is much more than reducing tariffs. It is actually taking a holistic approach towards addressing the on-the-ground constraints that paralyze the everyday producer, the everyday trader. And this is why, for example, trade facilitation is so important. A second important element that I wanted to mention is that this calls for regulatory reform and equally important for capacity building among the institutions that are charged with enforcing the regulation. The third point that I think is very relevant is that this integration agenda must cover services as well as goods. This is relevant because not only do services themselves present important export opportunities, but also because services are key inputs for enhancing competitiveness into the production of goods, including manufacturing. So it is very relevant that we take this approach that includes also services. And finally, action is required both at the national level, but also at the supranational level. For instance, there is an important role to be played by the regional communities by providing, for instance, the framework for reform, by bringing together countries, for example, to negotiate mutual recognition agreements. And it would be great, for instance, if accountants from one African country could deliver accounting services to other African countries, or health, or education. But then that should be complemented with the implementation capabilities at the national level. So working together supranational and national institutions could also contribute to breaking down the barriers that fragment Africa.
Some very good solutions there, very succinctly told. Richard Newfarmer, please stand up. Richard is the country director for Rwanda, South Sudan, and Uganda for the International Growth Center. Just tell us quickly what the International Growth Center is for those that don't know.
I can give you the long version if you'd like, Mark. Sure. No, I see. Okay. International Growth Center is a joint venture of the London School of Economics and Oxford University, financed by DFID, and we provide analytical services to 15 different countries, as well as long-term research on various policy issues.
So what's your question?
The question is, if you look at East Asia, one of the reasons why East Asia has integrated so dramatically, indicative in the trade figures that you cited earlier, Mark, is the emergence of regional value chains. Often the regional value chains linked to the global market and global value chains. I wondered if the panel could shed light on what they're doing and what the needs of Africa are to further the development of regional value chains beyond simply the normal agenda. I know the commissioner mentioned regional value chains in her remarks. This seems to me to be an important issue, and I wonder what kinds of things could be done to stimulate further development in Africa of regional value chains.
Thank you, Richard Newfarmer from the IGC there. Who wants to take that? Regional value chains. Annabelle.
I don't want to talk a lot here, but I'd like to say a word about regional value chains, because I do think that they represent very significant opportunities for African countries. If we look, for instance, at the integration of Lesotho and South Africa in the area of textiles, this is a very interesting example. But I think that we at the World Bank Group are looking at this in different ways. One is mapping the potential participation of African countries in regional and global value chains. And by doing that, identifying what are some of the binding constraints that are limiting the potential of African countries participating in regional or global value chains. And this binding constraints may refer to issues of trade facilitation, for instance, or may be related to trading services, or may be related to investment, for example, limitations on investment coming into the country, or maybe related about the, to the potential of domestic firms linking with other firms that participate in global or regional or global value chains. And I think that what we're seeing is that there are challenges and opportunities for many countries. And you can, for instance, take African countries, and I think that there's a great potential in many of them to develop regional value chains around the around minerals, around some of the commodities. For instance, in the case of phosphate for fertilizers, for example, this is something that has a case waiting to happen, if you wish, in a number of African countries. So again, to say that there's a lot of work going on the part of the World Bank Group in supporting African countries participate successfully in regional value chains.
Does anybody else want to add anything to that?
No, you go.
Oh, okay, thanks. I think this issue of regional value chain, in principle, yes, African countries should, and the Lesotho, South Africa is a very good example, but where we are today in terms of the production pattern of countries, which is reasonably not reasonably differentiated. You know, I make plastic chairs, you make plastic chairs, she makes plastic chairs. We have very little differentiation in our production pattern. Plus, the consumption and the market patterns are rather similar. So even if it's minerals, you know, where you have one mineral in country X, the neighboring country generally has the same mineral. So that is something that countries either will need to find a way to come together, in my view, to come together and exploit this without necessarily competing with one another, but kind of collaborating and looking at the global value chain and how they can come into it. Otherwise, without this adequately differentiated, I can't imagine how far Africa could go along this thing.
Go ahead, Frank.
Is that okay, Mark?
Yes, go ahead.
I'll try not to make the microphone go funny again. Essentially, you know, Richard, at Trademark, one of the things we're doing, a bit like Annabelle said, really, is we're looking at a number of key industries that are important for trade in East Africa, particularly for the landlocked countries. Because I think the other thing we haven't talked about is winners and losers. And let's face it, the coastal countries have benefited more in trade terms than the landlocked countries. So what we've done is we've looked at some key value chains for the trade baskets, coffee, staples, and then a service-based industry, which is important. I really agree with you on services. Tourism. And what we're really doing is doing market assessments and trying to understand what we can do to grow them. Now, are they regional value chains? In a way, they are. In a way, they're not. You know, there's not really a geographical division of production. But there are, as Gabriel said, countries are producing the same thing, and certainly with tourism, there's good potential for diversifying and thinking about different products. There's also a lot of commonalities, particularly on standards and non-tariff barriers. We're also looking with other partners at the garments and textile industry, where we're actually seeing now, quite interestingly enough, quite an economic, you know, spatial division of labor, you know, with, for example, cotton being ginned in Uganda, being transported across to Kenya, woven and spun, turned into garments, and then exported through Mombasa. Now, thinking about the geographical space and the costs associated with that, I had the pleasure to be at the EAC Manufacturing Summit about 2 or 3 months ago with the Secretary General. And really, you know, it was interesting looking at the logistics costs of that textile and garment industry. And some of them were telling me that broadly 45% of the value of the good was just transport and logistics alone. So one of the things we're trying to do, and I'm trying to answer your question maybe in a slightly long and roundabout way, but we're also looking at the role of logistics in these regional value chains. Because let's face it, for us to compete well on the global marketplace, we need to bring those costs down, the very high production cost. And by looking at some of those generic sectors that support other regional value chains, you can really do a lot more to improve competitiveness. So we're trying to look at it from two angles. The first is, you know, those value chains that can drive change for, you know, for folks in those value chains, but also thinking about the services that go into them. And it's very important, I think, particularly for manufacturing and processing.
I'm over here. Can you see me?
Oh, right.
Yeah, I'm here with a young gentleman that has a question for you. I think, Fatima, this might be yours. Just tell me who you are and what do you do?
My name is Dereba Mwangi Wainaina. I'm a business developer.
Okay, so what's your question?
I wanted to know how we handle the politics about Africa trade union herself. We have had a lot of suspicion between member countries, for example, Kenya, Tanzania, and Uganda being suspicious of each other. Then how are we going to handle the politics surrounding Africa trading between herself?
We saved the best for last, Fatima Haram Masil. Give it a shot.
Well, I guess I will give it a shot, but I'm not really sure. Maybe I understand what mean by suspicious between the country. I think that boosting intra-African trade, we know that, you know, this is something that head of state and government decided to do. We know that we have to move forward with it. We know that we want to trade because it has a lot of potentiality for job creation, for the value chain approach that we talk about. But I'm not really sure maybe about suspicious between the countries. And I mean, I don't know why the suspicion is between just African countries and why it's not...
No, but he does make a good point. Trade facilitation, reaching trade agreements is never an easy birth, never, around the world. It's difficult. There are political aspects to it, there are economic aspects, there's big versus small. There are a whole bunch of things. You have to be the uber diplomat. You have to kiss a lot of babies and shake a lot of hands in your job. He's just asking, how do you do it?
Well, I think it's a very difficult question, but let me say, put it that way. I think the political will is there. It's difficult to handle it. It's not an easy question because our economies are uneven. You know, we have small, we have big, we have rich, we have
Have landlocked, you have those that are coastal.
Exactly. So I think that is very difficult. But I think what's prevail is we have to understand the cost of non-integration is very high. The cost of non-integration means that Africa will still be fragmented. Africa will never speak with one voice. African people will still continue dying on the sea. It's going to be difficult to create employment in this continent. It's going to be difficult to have the infrastructure that is required. So the cost of non-integration is very important. And this is something that, as an African Union, we want to calculate the cost of non-integrating the African continent. Thank you. I hope I asked.
And there's a real sense that the clock is ticking, Annabelle. Yes, we haven't really talked about the private sector here.
Third point is that it's important also to begin with simple things that can show success. And probably a fourth element to say as well is that there needs to be some flexibility into it, so that countries may proceed at different speeds and in different combinations depending on their capacity. So I think that a combination of these 4 points is important in driving economic integration in the region.
Yeah, but you bring a very good point. I mean, what kind of model, if any, can African regional integration have that involves and engages the private sector? That's a very good point. We could go on all day about this subject matter. But Frank, maybe you want to just chime in on that one.
Yeah, no, I think the private sector voice is essential. I mean, and civil society, don't forget civil society, is also a very important stakeholder. I think it's really important to get the private sector behind a lot of this, and quite honestly, to show them how they're going to benefit, how these markets are going to grow, how the opportunities are going to grow. And sitting in East Africa every day, really, It's really satisfying to see businesses now tapping the regional market, beginning to export, and taking those opportunities. The way you can do that is setting up really solid platforms for private dialogue. And I'm blessed here in East Africa. We've got the East African Business Council. There's a lot of very successful work for women in trade, on standards, on all sorts of different things, bringing together the different national associations. As Annabelle said, in the end, regional is fine, but actually bringing together national players that actually do a lot of this on the ground is really important. So I think bringing the private sector in is incredibly important, and particularly behind this trade facilitation agreement, that has really the potential to benefit the private sector massively. And I think there's a lot more to do in bringing the private sector into some of those reforms itself.
Can I ask all of you to stand, please? Please, can I ask you to stand? Fatima, Jean, Gabriel, Frank, Annabelle. This has been your panel on Africa Integrates. Give them a robust round of applause. Thank you. You were great.